My story to all of you, my story is about the Maharaja man. And I must take you back many, many years when India did not have an airline, a commercial airline, and JRD Tata thought that this nation requires an airline for its development. So in 1938, he started what was called Tata Airlines. He flew the first flight himself. JRD at that time was a young man in his 30s. He flew the first flight from Karachi to Ahmedabad to Mumbai in a puss moth plane. And that plane landed at Juhu Aerodrome in Mumbai and started Airmail in India and started the first commercial airline in India. Tata Airlines later went to become Air India. And at some stage thereafter, it was nationalized by the government. And today it's an airline run by the government, though JRD Tata served as chairman of that airline for many, many years, even after it was nationalized. But this story is not about JRD Tata alone. It is about the Air India Maharaja, and it is about the man who created the Air India Maharaja. Someone whom some of you might have heard of, some of you might not have heard of, but he worked very closely with JRD Tata for several decades, and his name was Bobby Kuka. Bobby Kuka, a Parsi gentleman, his name was Sohrab Kaikushru Kuka, and JRD Tata still narrates. He says, this man burst into my office one morning in 1938, the airline had just begun. He came and told me all about the deficiencies that the Tata organization has and how he was necessary to put all those deficiencies right. He recalls that Bobby Kuka had come out of some other job that he was doing earlier, where he was there only for a year or two. And then JRD told himself that if he has to find a home for this person, he said, I decided if there was any place for him in the Tata Group, it would be in Tata Airlines. And he goes on to say, perhaps I thought I was not taking any large risk of making a permanent commitment because the chances of survival of Tata Airlines those days was pretty dim. Bobby Kuka also remembers that meeting. He said, I went into JRD Tata's office, this grand office, and here was this man. I was warned that he was a terror. He was a chairman of the Tata Group. I went heart and mouth to his office. He asked me some searching questions, and he says, I could not answer any of those questions. And he was obviously so impressed that I was taken out of his room, ushered out of his room in a second or two. But that was Bobby Kuka. That was his style of speaking. But he was really one of the first marketing wizards of our country. Because after he joined Air India and he spent a few years as their secretary, he decided to give this brand an image. उस जमाने में एयर इंडिया का टाटा एयरलाइंस का एक ही बुकिंग ऑफिस था जो चर्च गेट में किया था. They had made it in Church Gate next to the Asiatic Society, and that is where Bobby Kuka used to sit and conduct his business. So he decided one day, what is a good symbol of India? A good symbol of India to the rest of the world, a Maharaja, luxury, that's where the world of India comes from, Taj Mahal. So he decided to create an oriental man shaped like a Maharaja, sitting on a flying carpet, smoking a hookah, one of those bubble hookahs, with a turban which was striped. He did this along with a gentleman called Umesh Rao of J. Walter Thompson, the advertising agency. And he put this in the show window of the Air India booking office at Churchill. This was the first time that a round face, a large outsized mustache, many of you may remember seeing the Air India Maharaja, a striped turban and a long nose. This was the birth of the Air India Maharaja. And what a symbol that was, ladies and gentlemen. For the next several decades, the Air India Maharaja dominated the skies. Please remember, Google Doodle started. When Air India started its flights to Rome, the Air India Maharaja converted himself into a Romeo. And there he was in the guise of a Romeo. when the Beatles came to India and went to Rishikesh for transcendental meditation, the Arindya Maharaja became the guru of transcendental meditation along with the Beatles. When Arindya went to Tokyo, the Arindya Maharaja became a sumo wrestler in Tokyo. The Arindya Maharaja commented on political happenings in the country. There were politicians, there was Indira Gandhi, there was Kriplani, there was Morarji Desai, all of whom featured in a funny way in Arindya Maharaja advertising, like many of you may be seeing in the Amul Girl advertisement. And Bobby Kuka decided that just like the Maharaja, the culture of India is what underpins Arindya, and this culture of India, just like the Indian food that is served on Arindya, this culture of Air India should be reflected in the offices of Air India across the world. So the Maharaja was all across the world, in Geneva, in London, in Tokyo, in Rome, in all the offices of Air India, in New York. But in addition to that, what Bobby Kuka did was, he also put up in all these offices the symbols of Indian culture. So in each of these offices, you had a beautiful showcase of the country's heritage, Indian imagery, Indian dance, Indian paintings, Indian sculpture. Images of these appeared in the offices of Air India across the world. In the 60s, Air India was recognized as one of the finest airlines in the world. Airlines, when Singapore won, Singapore Airlines, Lee Kuan Yew, the then Prime Minister of Singapore, is reported to have told his people, go and study Air India, find out how they are so punctual. Find out how they reflect the culture of India. Find out how they offer such wonderful customer experience. And there was Bobby Kuka, the man behind the Maharaja and the marketing of Air India. One of the people who worked, there were many talented marketing people who worked with Bobby Kuka. One of the people who worked with Bobby Kuka for 11 years was the filmmaker Muzaffar Ali, whom all of us know through Gaman and Umrao Jaan. So Muzaffar Ali, working team of Air India with Bobby Kuka, and this is what he says. For 11 years I was on a flight, dreaming through the eyes of Bobby Kuka and his mentor JRD Tata. For 11 years I was honest to myself and to the vision of these two stalwarts. And he goes on to say, I was not working for Air India, I was working for India. I was looking at the beauty and the ugliness of our country. I was looking at dance, at paintings, at sculptures. I was looking at a sari as the most exquisite expression of Indian feminine grace. I was looking at service to a passenger as a welcome to a god, the legend of Krishna as an ambience of divine love in an aircraft. That was Muzaffar Ali for you, speaking about the days that he spent together with Bobby Kuka. What wonderful words. But when you are working with a genius, and a marketing genius like Bobby Kuka, he comes with his quirks. He was a maverick. There were many, many storms in teacups, so to speak. So the Tata Group at that time had a house magazine called Tata Bulletin, a house magazine for employees. And JRD Tata says, somehow Bobby Kuka became the editor of the last page of the magazine. He says, I don't know how, but he became. And when he became the editor of the last page of the magazine, he used to play havoc with the whole Tata organization by demolishing the ego of every Tata director and senior official. Later on in Air India Holdings, he demolished and punctured innumerable egos, which placed me at the receiving end of endless complaints from MPs and ministers, including Mr. Morarji Desai and Mr. Krishna Menon. And I'm reading these lines from what JRD Tata said at Bobby Kuka's farewell. And apparently Mr. Morarji Desai and Mr. Krishna Menon were depicted in red pants running a track race with Mr. Kriplani. But JRD Tata went on to say, you know, at his farewell, he went on to say, I forgive Kuka all the scars that I have borne because of the laughter and the relief from frustration and boredom that he provided to thousands and perhaps millions. JRD Tata truly provided Bobby Kuka with the required support during that period of time because he recognized that was the nature of genius. He also recognized the need for some benign humor in the midst of our daily challenges. Every day in our office, we have challenges, we have issues, we have opportunities, and the need for some humor in it is what Bobby Kuka was able to provide. Bobby Kuka retired in 1971 1 year after the first jumbo aircraft came into Air India, and J.R.D. Tata actually said at his retirement farewell, "May you never cease tilting at windmills, at the pretentious, at the charlatans and the hypocrites of the world." And, you know, in a way, this reminds me of one of J.R.D. Tata's key secrets to his success. He led the Tata Group for 50 years. He led Air India for an equal period of time. He created Tata Airlines, as I told you. But when asked about his success, J.R.D. Tata says that one of the key secrets to my success is getting on with individuals according to their ways and characteristics. He says, to be a good leader, you have to lead human beings with affection. J.R.D. Tata led Bobby Kuka with that affection, with that same human affection. And in turn, Bobby Kuka created that fabulous, successful marketing and publicity machine for the nation's flagship airline, including the creation and the nurturing of the charming Air India Maharaja. He was the Maharaja man. Thank you.